In this video, I'll show you the best way to mod a Nintendo GameCube. This mod will allow you to boot directly into SWIS, play all your games from an SD card, and even run homebrew software, including emulators. I'll be showing the PicoBoot mod chip installation process from start to finish, so stay tuned. PicoBoot is an open source mod chip created by WebHDX. This mod chip utilizes a Raspberry Pi Pico board, making it cheap and easy to install. To complete this mod, you will need one Raspberry Pi Pico, an SD to memory card adapter, or an SD to SP2. I'll be using the memory card adapter since my serial adapter hasn't come in the mail yet. You will also need an SD card. Any size will work, but the bigger, the better. Just a quick note about deciding which adapter to use. Before you buy an SD to SP2 adapter, make sure your GameCube has the correct serial port on the bottom of the console. Some consoles were shipped without this port entirely. Please check the description for links to all of the equipment and software used in this video. First, remove any game discs or memory cards that may still be in your console. If your console has a Game Boy player attached, you'll need to loosen these two captive flathead bolts on the bottom. Then remove the Game Boy player. Next, remove the four screws from the bottom of the console. You will need a game bit driver to do this. After that, turn the console back upright and gently remove the top shell. Now the front panel can be removed by tilting it forward and unplugging the ribbon cable. The rear panel lifts off easily. Remove the fan and power switch assembly by unplugging this power connection and removing the two screws that hold the module in place. You will need a Phillips head screwdriver for the rest of the screws inside the console. Next, remove the 16 screws securing the optical drive assembly. All of these screws are located around the edges of the GameCube. There are four on the back side, three on the left side underneath where the fan was, four on the front side above the memory card ports, and five more on the right side. Now the optical drive assembly can be removed. For full access to the GameCube's motherboard, this heatsink must also be removed. There are six Phillips head screws that secure the heatsink. Carefully move the heatsink back and forth until it can be removed from the console. You may need to replace the thermal pads if they do not come off in one piece. I'll leave a link to a good replacement set in the video description, just in case. Now we're going to take a look at the solder points for installing this mod chip, starting with this chip right here. Depending on the revision of your GameCube's motherboard, this chip may be in a different location. The GameCube featured in this video is a DOL001. Wiring diagrams for both motherboard revisions are available on the PicoBoot GitHub page. Link in the description below. I'm going to start by adding some solder to the pin that has a blue label in the wiring diagram. This pin will be connected to GP4 on the Raspberry Pi. After adding solder to the pin, the wire can be attached by simply heating it up and letting the solder flow onto the wire. I'll be using a different colored wire for each connection to avoid any confusion when it's time to install the mod chip. I do recommend using a little flux on small connections like this. Next, I'll be connecting the yellow wire. This wire will be connected to pins GP6 and GP7 on the Raspberry Pi. The remaining three connections are made using this group of pins. I'm going to make the ground connection first. The ground wire has a black label in the wiring diagram. To connect this wire, you'll need to bridge these two pins together with solder. Then make sure the grounding wire is connected to both of these pins. Next, I'll be attaching the wire that has a pink label in the wiring diagram. I'll be using a white wire though. This wire will get connected to GP5 on the Raspberry Pi. The last pin we'll need to connect is for the voltage wire. This wire has a red label in the wiring diagram. This wire will get connected to the 3V3 pin on the Raspberry Pi. Covering the wires with a piece of heat shrink tubing will help protect the wires from the rough edges of the GameCube enclosure. Now it's time to start putting things back together, beginning with this heatsink. Replace the 6 heatsink screws. They're the ones with the little washer on them, in case you forgot. The new mod chip wires will get in the way of the optical drive. You can make a small modification by bending this tab to create just enough space for our new wires to go through. Next, replace the 16 screws around the perimeter of the GameCube. Next, reinstall the fan assembly. This piece is completely optional, but I will be using this little 3D printed mounting bracket. The 3D model for this object is provided by Zed Labs. It is designed to secure the Raspberry Pi Pico with two M2.5 5mm screws. Now it's time to flash the firmware onto the Raspberry Pi Pico. While holding down the boot SEL button, plug the Raspberry Pi into your computer. If this is done correctly, you will see a storage device appear on your computer labeled RPI-RP2. You will need to drag and drop the picoboot.uf2 file onto the internal storage of the Raspberry Pi. I'll have a link to where you can download this file in the video description. The Raspberry Pi storage device will automatically eject itself from your PC, and the green LED will light up on the Raspberry Pi if the programming was successful. Now you can begin connecting the Raspberry Pi Pico to the GameCube. As shown in the wiring diagram, connect the black wire to the ground pin. Connect the red wire to the 3V3 pin. Connect the blue wire to the GP4 pin. Connect the pink wire, or in my case the white wire, to the GP5 pin. And connect the yellow wire to both GP6 and GP7. Now it's time to secure the Raspberry Pi inside the GameCube. Since I'm using this 3D printed bracket, I'm going to go ahead and put 2 screws in. You could also hold the Raspberry Pi down with double-sided tape or cover it with electrical tape, as long as it stays inside the console and doesn't interfere with any of the other pieces. Now to finish reassembling. Reattach the front panel, making sure to plug in the ribbon cable. Replace the back panel. Then slide on the top cover of the GameCube. Now replace the 4 bottom bolts that hold the console together. If you have a Game Boy player, reinstall the Game Boy player and tighten the 2 flathead bolts. Congratulations! Your mod chip is now installed. To get the most out of your new mod chip, you will need to set up an SD card so your GameCube can boot into SWIS. No matter the size of your SD card, you'll want to make sure it's formatted to use the FAT32 file system. I recommend using GUI format to format your SD card before installing SWIS. I'll leave a link to where you can get GUI format in the description below. SWIS is an all-in-one homebrew launcher for the Nintendo GameCube. I recommend heading over to the SWIS GitHub page and downloading the latest release. After downloading SWIS, extract the files and then place the SWIS folder in the root directory of your SD card. Next, navigate inside the SWIS folder and into the DOL folder. Inside, you will find a file named swiss_ followed by the version number.dol. Right-click on this file and select Cut. Then return to the root directory of your SD card and paste the file. You will then have to rename this file to ipl.dol. Those are all the files needed to boot into SWIS. Next, you can begin to move some games onto your SD card. Here, I'm going to create a folder named GameCube Games. Simply copy and paste your game collection somewhere on your SD card. GameCube Games must be in the .iso format. After that, you can plug your SD card back into the GameCube using the memory card adapter of your choice. Your GameCube should now automatically boot into SWIS. SWIS lets you browse through all the files that are stored on your SD card. As you can see here, I have already installed some other software alongside my collection of GameCube games. And that pretty much covers everything you need to know to play your GameCube games off of an SD card with this mod chip. Now that the basics are up and running, let's take a look at some of the other things this GameCube can do. The GC Forever Wiki is an excellent resource for GameCube homebrew. I'll have a link to this page posted in the description below. In this demonstration, I'll be installing SNES 9X GX. This Super Nintendo emulator has been ported to run on the GameCube. To install an emulator like this, simply follow the download link on the GC Forever page and download the version of the software designed for the Nintendo GameCube. Extract the files and then place the SNES 9X DOL file on your SD card. Of course, you will also need to add some ROMs to your SD card. After returning your SD card to your GameCube, you can navigate to the snes9x.dol file to boot the software. The snes9x interface will open to a file browser. From there, you can navigate to your ROMs. This process is much the same for other homebrew software, although every link available on the GC Forever Wiki does include a tutorial on how to get the software running on your system. There's one more piece of software I want to show you in this tutorial. The Game Boy Interface is a free alternative to the Game Boy Player Startup Disk. To download Game Boy Interface, check out the Game Boy Interface page over on the GC Forever Wiki. Click the link that says Download Main Package. After downloading, extract those files and drag the contents onto the root of your SD card. Here, I'm going to make an extra folder for my Game Boy Interface DOL file. I'll name it Game Boy Interface and make sure that it appears third in my SWIS menu. If you choose to set up Game Boy Interface like this, you'll need to navigate inside the Apps menu and then inside the GBI folder and cut the gbi.dol file and paste it to the directory from which you would like to launch the application. Next, you'll need to navigate inside your SWIS folder and inside the Action Replay folder. Right-click on the autoexec.dol file and select Cut. Then return to the root directory of your SD card and paste the file. To make sure you have this set up correctly, make sure you have the GBI, MC Backup, and autoexec.dol files in the root directory. After returning the SD card to your GameCube, simply navigate to where you stored the gbi.dol file. Launching this will start the Game Boy Player. You will find that Game Boy Interface offers many features that the original Game Boy Player disc does not. My favorite thing about this software is it could easily be paired with a Game Boy Flash cart to store a large library of Game Boy Advance ROMs on your GameCube. That's all that I have to share with you today about this amazing new mod chip. I definitely recommend trying this mod out for yourself, especially if you're as big a fan of the GameCube as I am. Be sure to subscribe to the channel and go follow me on Twitch. Leave a like on this video if you liked it, and why not leave a comment of what console you would like to see on the channel next. I'll see you all in the next video. Thank you for watching.